There's a sling in my stone, not a stone in my praise. Pushing back when the darkest weapons form. And there's a power on my lips, even death can defy. When the name of our God is lifted high, and there is resurrection power when we sing the name of Jesus. Resurrection power when we raise a mighty sound. So come on, let the praise get loud. Make that empty grave resound. There is resurrection power in his name. There are days I have seen, filled with heartache and loss, that have buried my heart beneath the weight. But every time his praise breaks out, dead things rise up from the ground. I'm only in my song inside that empty.
There is resurrection. glad that you chose to spend your Easter Sunday with us. It is so good to worship together as a church family. And some of you have your friends and your family and your neighbors with you. And we are so grateful that you're here. Welcome to Graystone. When you came in, you should have received a handout that has the talk notes, but also a communication card. We would love for you to fill that out during the service for us. We're going to continue to worship, but before we do that, will you stand up and say hello and happy Easter to those around you?
Thank you, Jesus, for the blood. Glory to His name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to His name. Hallelujah. Addiction starts to break, declaring there is hope and there is freedom. I speak Jesus. Darkness over every enemy. Jesus, for my family, I speak the holy name. wanna speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind. 'Cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus.
UFO.
I'd say I believe in UFOs. I don't know what they are exactly, but
UFOs. Yeah, absolutely. Things that are flying around and we don't know what they are, but they're probably terrestrial. They're probably, you know, your neighbor's little airplane or something.
Yeah. We can't be alone, right?
100%. I mean, we don't know what's out there in space. Who knows what's coming up in the atmosphere? Not me.
I believe there's a possibility that there may be life on other planets.
Yes. Yeah.
Have you ever seen a UFO?
No.
Do you believe in Bigfoot?
There hasn't been enough sightings for me, so I'd say no.
I would say I believe there may be something out there, but to say a big creature walking like a human, I don't know.
Why do you believe in Bigfoot?
I mean, there gotta be something out there, you feel me?
You know what? I do.
Believe in Bigfoot?
Yeah, I have two right here.
What about the Illuminati? Do you believe in the Illuminati?
Yeah, I believe in the Illuminati.
Oh, no. Nah.
I got no comment.
No, pleading the fifth. What about, have you ever heard of the Illuminati?
The Illuminati? Oh, yeah. Yeah, I think they control everything, right?
Okay.
You believe that?
I don't know.
Okay. What do you believe about Jesus? Do you believe he was real?
I believe he was real. I don't know if he was the actual son or not of God, but I do believe that he was real and he was a good man and he's a good example to follow.
Do you believe in Jesus?
Yes.
Oh, yes. Yeah. Yes.
Okay. Sure. I mean, yeah.
You believe that he was real?
Yeah, he was.
Okay.
Yeah.
I do believe in Jesus.
100% believe in Jesus.
That's a loaded question. Honestly, don't like going into religion.
Oh, yeah. I definitely believe in Jesus.
Okay. All right.
Yeah.
All right.
He's an Allah man. I ain't gonna lie. Wait, the same person. Yeah, I'm tripping. I'm surprising.
Hey, can we give the choir a big hand? How awesome was that? How awesome was that? Happy Easter. So glad you guys are here. I have some important questions for you. I want to get started off. How many of you guys, by show of hands, believe in UFOs? How many of you? Okay, pretty good amount of people. Like, there could be life on other planets. Like, we're just our little Earth. We're part of a solar system, part of the Milky Way galaxy, and there's millions and millions of galaxies. So there could be life on other planets. How many of you guys believe in Bigfoot? Like, okay, there's, like, potential Sasquatch running around the woods. We're pretty sure he likes beef jerky, right? Like, how many of you guys believe in the Illuminati? There's a cobalt, there's a powerful group of people who are actually running the world. How many of you guys believe in sea monsters? Like, we don't know what's down there, right? And I have to confess to you guys, I believe in sea monsters. I have caught a sea monster. And I don't know if I've shown y'all this picture. Have I shown y'all this picture? This prehistoric fish that I caught last fall. It's actually the largest fish that's ever been caught in my dad's 14-foot fiberglass skiff. You know, it's interesting that I've shown this picture on several occasions. Like, there's cold, hard facts that I've caught this fish. I have video of me catching the fish and my dad with the landing net. My dad has testified, like eyewitness testimony, that I caught this fish. And there's still people who don't believe that I caught this fish. I want to talk today about true belief. And if you're taking notes, point number one is true belief is based upon facts, not feelings. Now, in order to truly believe in UFOs and Bigfoot and sea monsters, we have to have some evidence. We have to have some cold, hard facts. Now, it's fun to debate the existence of aliens or Bigfoot. But what I really want to talk about today is Jesus. Do you believe in Jesus? Because the reason we're here is we are celebrating Easter Sunday. We're celebrating the greatest event in the history of the world, the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. And the question I have for you guys today is, do you really believe it? Like, do you really believe in the resurrection of Jesus Christ? Because if you really believe it, I believe it, it will change your life. Like, it will radically change your life. So I want us to look at the evidence today, and I want you to determine, do you really believe this? Because if you really believe it, it's going to change your life forever. Now, let me remind you what Christians believe, okay? This is a summary of what we believe. We believe that God himself, in the form of the Son, came to be one of us. He was born of the Virgin Mary by way of immaculate conception. He is the fulfillment of hundreds of Old Testament prophecies. We believe that he lived a perfect life, that he was without sin, meaning he's the exact opposite of us because we are sinful people. We are all born into sin. We're born into original sin. We have sinful parents who had sinful parents who had sinful parents all the way back to Adam and Eve in the garden. Jesus didn't have sinful parents. He was conceived of the Holy Spirit. He lived a perfect life. He was without sin. He never told a lie. He never stole anything. He never gossiped or talked bad about anyone. He never had a lustful thought. He never worried about finances. He never bragged about catching a big fish. He was perfect. And he was the perfect sacrifice for our sins. He died on the cross for us. The penalty for sin is death. And for our sin, Jesus Christ died on the cross for us. He died in our place. It's by his wounds that we have been healed. It's through the shedding of his blood that we have forgiveness of sins. And he died on the cross, and he was buried. He was wrapped in mummy clothes, and he was put in the tomb. The stone was rolled across the tomb. And that's where I want to pick up the story today. We're looking at John's gospel, John chapter 20. And this is John's eyewitness account to Jesus' life and his death and his resurrection. John chapter 20, verse 1 and following says, "Early on the first day of the week, While it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved. Now John loved to refer to himself as the disciple whom Jesus loved. He's the one writing this. He's the other disciple. And said, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they have put him." So Peter and the other disciple started for the tomb. Both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. It's important to John for us to know that he's faster than Peter. He mentions it several times in here. I don't know how competitive he was, but he mentions it several times in here that he's faster than Peter. He wants all the world to know that. He outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent over and looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in. Then Simon Peter, who was behind him, arrived and went into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the burial cloth that had been around Jesus' head. The cloth was folded up by itself, separate from the linen. Finally, the other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, also went inside. He saw and believed. The apostle John sees an empty tomb. He sees that Jesus has folded up the grave clothes and set them on the bed. Like the apostle John, he saw an empty tomb, he saw the grave clothes, and he believed. Like he didn't need much evidence. And maybe the Holy Spirit revealed it to him. But he had a childlike faith, and there are some of us who have a childlike faith. Like we don't need that much evidence. It all makes sense to us. The light bulb goes off and God reveals himself to us. But others of us are more skeptical. Many of us are skeptical by nature. We need some more evidence here other than just an empty tomb and the grave clothes being folded up. Verse 10, then the disciples went back to their homes, but Mary stood outside the tomb crying. As she wept, she bent over to look in the tomb and saw two angels in white seated where Jesus had been, one at the head and the other at the foot. And they asked her, "Woman, why are you crying?" "They have taken my Lord away," she said. "I don't know where they've put him." At this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she didn't realize it was Jesus. "Woman," he said, "why are you crying? Who is it you're looking for?" Thinking he was the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you've carried him away, tell me where you've put him and I'll get him." And Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned toward him and cried in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said, "Don't hold on to me, for I've not yet returned to the Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell them I'm returning to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." And Mary Magdalene went to the disciples with the news, "I've seen the Lord," and she told them that he had said these things to her. And so Mary, she doesn't believe at first. She doesn't just believe because there's an empty tomb. But she sees two angels sitting in the tomb. She has a conversation with two angels. And then she sees Jesus himself, and then Jesus calls her by name, and she believes. And she goes and she testifies to the disciples, but they still don't believe. Verse 19, on the evening of the first day of the week, so that first Sunday, that first Easter Sunday, when the disciples were together with the doors locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side, and the disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone his sins, they are forgiven. And if you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." So then the disciples believe. They didn't just believe because they saw the empty tomb. They believe because they saw the resurrected Jesus. They saw his hands and they saw his side. And they believed. And they tell Thomas about this, but listen to what Thomas says. Now Thomas, called Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We've seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my finger where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe it. Now, this is Thomas. And Thomas is getting eyewitness testimony from 10 of his closest friends. And they're like, no, we've seen the Lord. Like, he was standing right here. We saw the nail marks. We saw the hole in his side. Like, wait, like we've seen Jesus. He's risen from the grave. He's resurrected. And Thomas says, unless I see it for myself and unless I touch his hands and touch his side, I'm not going to believe it. A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, peace be with you. Then he said to Thomas, put your finger here. See my hands? Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe. Jesus tells Thomas, stop doubting and believe. And that could be a message that God is saying to some of you today. Stop doubting and believe. And Thomas said to him, my Lord and my God. It took Thomas touching Jesus. And so you see, there's different levels of evidence it takes for certain people to believe. Some people believe like John, it's like they see the empty tomb, and they believe. Other people need more evidence and more facts. And Jesus Christ, we're gonna see that over the next 40 days, and it says in 1 Corinthians 15, 3-6, I'm gonna go ahead and read the passage. For what I received, I passed on you as of first importance, that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures, and that he appeared to Peter and then to the 12, and after that he appeared to more than 500 of the brothers and sisters at the same time. More than 500 eyewitnesses to the resurrection of Jesus Christ. The question I have for you today is do you truly believe? Do you believe that Jesus is the Son of God? Do you believe that he died on the cross for our sins? And do you believe that on the third day he rose from the grave? Do you truly believe? I wanna push you today. I wanna challenge your faith today. Like the message that I'm sharing today is not one of these feel-good Easter messages. It's a message that's gonna challenge you. And I'm gonna share with you some of the things that Jesus taught. He teaches some pretty radical things. And do we believe the teaching of Jesus? And so, really important questions. Do you believe in Jesus? Do you believe that the Bible is the inspired word of God? Like, did you really believe that? Do you believe that there's life after death? Like, do you really believe it? Like, do you believe in heaven? Do you believe in hell? Because if you do, it will radically change your life. And it will radically change your life for the better. The Bible is clear that life is short. The Bible says we're but a mist, we're but a vapor. We're here today, we're gone tomorrow. And that there's two eternal destinations, heaven and hell. Heaven is not our default destination. Hell is. Because we're all born sinful. We're all born into original sin, and the penalty for our sin is death. And Jesus taught, listen to this, Jesus taught the majority of the people in our world are not going to heaven. It's Jesus' words, Jesus' teaching. That would mean the majority of the people who live in our country aren't going to heaven. The majority of the people who live in our community aren't going to heaven. The majority of the people who go to our kids' schools aren't going to heaven. The majority of the people on our kids' ball teams are not going to heaven. The majority of the people who live in our neighborhoods aren't going to heaven. Look what Jesus said in Matthew 7, 13-14. Enter through the narrow gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the road that leads to destruction, and many enter through it. But small is the gate and narrow is the road that leads to life, and only a few people find it. Jesus says only a few people are on the narrow road. You know, only a few people are entering through the small gate, the narrow road that leads to eternal life. The majority of the world are on the broad road that leads to destruction. He said only a few people find it. Most people don't. Most people are not going to heaven. And then he doubles down on this, and he says a lot of people who think they're going to heaven aren't going to heaven. Look at verse 21, Matthew 7, 21. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. Are you on the narrow road? Are you fulfilling God's will for your life? Is your life radically different than your neighbors and your coworkers and your friends? Jesus is super clear. This is some tough teaching. He wants us to take heaven and hell very seriously. Look at Matthew 18, 8 and 9. If your hand or your foot causes you to stumble, cut it off and throw it away. It is better for you to enter life maimed or crippled than to have two hands or two feet and be thrown into eternal fire. And if your eye causes you to stumble, gouge it out and throw it away. It is better for you to enter life with one eye than to have two eyes and to be thrown into the fire of hell. Now, Jesus is using a figure of speech. I mean, he's not literally saying that we should cut off our hand or gouge out our eye if it's causing us to stumble. But he wants us to take very seriously eternal life. And if there's something that is keeping us from going to heaven, Jesus is saying, get rid of it. Like get it out of your life. And if we truly believe in heaven, like if we really believe in heaven, we would get it out of our lives because we don't want anything to keep us from spending eternity in heaven with God. Because life is short. We're but a mist, we're but a vapor. Eternity is forever. Now a lot of us, this has become a reality for a lot of us recently. A lot of us have lost loved ones recently. We realize how short life is, but our hope is in heaven. Jesus said it in Luke 9, 23 through 25. Then he said to them all, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross daily and follow me. Whoever wants to save their life will lose it, but whoever loses their life for me will save it. And then he says, what good is it for someone to gain the whole world, yet forfeit or lose their very self? What good is it? Like, what good is it to gain the whole world, yet forfeit your very soul? And Jesus says our soul is worth more than the world. It's worth more than anything. Our soul's worth more than our house, more than our car, more than our money, more than our possessions. And Jesus goes on and says, to get to go to heaven, it's worth selling everything. I love this parable, Matthew 13, 45 and 46. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant on the lookout for choice pearls. When he discovered a pearl of great value, he sold everything he owned and bought it. Once we truly believe in heaven, we're willing to sell everything. We're willing to give up everything for that which is priceless. And if you truly believe, you'll become a follower of Jesus. Have you surrendered everything to Jesus? See, true belief causes radical life change. Once you truly believe, your life will radically change. We have the example of the disciples. They're hiding in the upper room. They're scared of the Jews. They're fearful for their lives. On Good Friday, Peter denies Jesus three times. They see a resurrected Jesus. Their entire lives change. Peter goes from hiding in the upper room to just 50 days later preaching at Pentecost to thousands and thousands of people. Peter ended up dying a martyr's death. He died for his faith in Jesus. He was crucified upside down. Talk about life change. Talk about hiding in the upper room to giving your life away for Jesus. 10 of the 11 disciples died a martyr's death. They died for their faith. And John, he was put in prison. He was exiled to the island of Patmos because of his faith. We look at the Apostle Paul. His life was radically changed. He was Saul. He was persecuting the church. He was murdering Christians. He was on the road to Damascus. He has an encounter with the resurrected Jesus. And his whole life changes. He says in Galatians 2:20, I've been crucified with Christ. And I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Paul says, I've been crucified with Christ. Like, I have died to myself. I'm no longer living. Like, Paul is no longer living. Jesus is living in me. Jesus is living through me. His entire life. When you put your faith in Jesus, you experience a radical life change. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old is gone and the new has come. Today, we're celebrating baptisms. I can't think of any better day to celebrate baptisms than Easter Sunday. Because baptism illustrates a couple powerful things. One, it illustrates Jesus' resurrection. When a person is put under the water, symbolic of Jesus being put into the grave. And when that person comes up out of the water, it's symbolic of the resurrected to new life. Baptism is also symbolic of the changed life. When someone goes under the water, it's a putting to death of the old life. It's symbolic of the cleansing of sin. And when that person comes up out of the water, they're beginning a new life in Christ. Like, the old is gone and the new has come. Like, radical life change. When someone commits his life to Jesus, their life radically changes. Everything about their life changes. His heart, his soul, his thoughts, his attitude, his language, his countenance, his body, his relationships, his schedule, his work, his priorities, his whole life changes. He's now living a God-centered, God-focused, heaven-bound life. He's pursuing righteousness and holiness and the upward call of God on his life. He's now living in light of eternity. His heart and his mind are focused on things above. He's storing up treasures in heaven because he knows he's going to spend eternity there. And he is doing everything within his power to make sure that his wife and his kids and his family and his friends are all going to go to heaven with him. His life is radically changed. He doesn't just come to church on big holidays. He worships weekly. He's in the Word of God daily, and he is passionate about serving God. And when people look at his life, they're crystal clear about what he's about. Oh, that dude? He's a follower of Jesus. Like, that guy? He's one of Jesus' men. As for he and his family, like, they're serving the Lord. He not only talks the talk, but he walks the walk. Our family was on vacation last week. We went down to Destin. We love the beach. We talk about that a lot. And whenever we go down to Destin, we typically go about once a year. First thing we do, first morning, donut hole, right? And we pretty much eat donut hole donuts every morning. Then we go and plop down the beach. We're snacking all day. We go out and we eat seafood. It's bluebell ice cream at night. So we're putting on a lot of calories, right? So I like to try to work out when I'm there. And I'm not real big on like running. So my workout is getting in the steam room. I call it the executive workout because you don't have to do anything. You just sit in the steam room, right? And your heart rate gets up. It's kind of similar to running. You know, your heart rate gets up and you're sweating Then you go do a cold plunge in the pool. Well, after all of this food, I thought, I gotta have like a real workout. And so I go to the weight room, go to the gym, and I'm lifting weights. And I look over there, and I see this older gentleman kind of balding on top, gray, you know, getting a little bit gray. And he's working out. And I'm like, this guy looks familiar to me. You know, so the whole time I'm working out, I'm looking at this guy. Kind of stalking him a little bit. He might have been getting a little bit uncomfortable. But then I realized, like, he's not actually an older gentleman. Like, he and I are the same age. Like, we grew up together. Like, we played tennis together. We were in the same high school fraternity. And then I thought to myself, man, he looks way older than me. But he was probably thinking the same thing, right? So I go over to him, like, John Martin. He's like, Jonathan Howes. And so we, like, reconnected. And I hadn't seen him in forever. And I knew he lived in Destin. I knew he was a real estate agent. So I started asking about real estate, you know, down in Destin and condos and all, because I was interested in these things. He says, really what I'm passionate about is serving God. And I thought, wow, I'm wanting to talk about real estate. He's wanting to talk about Jesus. So he begins to tell me, and he knew I was a Christian and I was a pastor and all that. And so he begins to tell me that his whole life has changed. I asked him what church he went to, and he told me his church, which we were actually at that church last Sunday. He told me he's committed to the small group and to tithing and to evangelism and discipleship. And he actually leads the podcast for his church, which is called The Road to Redemption. And he sent me his podcast, which had his testimony. And of course, I sent him our Family Goals podcast. And I thought, man, his whole life has radically changed. And I was thinking to myself, God is so good. Because I look back on our lives. And when we were 15, 16 years old, we were on that broad road that leads to destruction. We were in this high school fraternity that could be described like Animal House. We had this car that we all pitched in and bought, and we saws off the top off of it, and we had our fraternity letters on the side. We had a toilet seat in the trunk, and we had a beer tab on the hood. And I thought, our lives have radically changed. God is so, it was so encouraging for me to see how God had changed his life. Now, true belief leads to an unashamed faith. I love that we're standing in the middle of that gym, and he said, well, really, what I'm really passionate about is serving God. Like, he didn't waste any time with small talk. I love this declaration. And I don't know if you've heard this before or read this before. It's called the Fellowship of the Unashamed. And I want to read it today. And I want you to think about your life. Does this describe your life? Says, I'm a part of the fellowship of the unashamed. The die has been cast. I've stepped over the line. The decision has been made. I am a disciple of Jesus Christ. I won't look back, let up, slow down, back away, or be still. My past is redeemed. My present makes sense. My future is secure. I am finished and done with low living, sight walking, small planning, smooth knees, colorless dreams, chitsy giving, and dwarf goals. I no longer need preeminence, prosperity, position, promotions, plaudits, or popularity. I now live by presence, lean by faith, love by patience, lift by prayer, and labor by power. My pace is set, my gait is fast, my goal is heaven. My road is narrow, my way is rough, my companions few, my guide reliable, my mission clear. I cannot be bought, compromised, detoured, lured away, turned back, deluded, or delayed. I will not flinch in the face of sacrifice, hesitate in the presence of adversity, negotiate at the table of the enemy, ponder at the pool of popularity, or meander in the maze of mediocrity. I am a disciple of Jesus Christ. I must go until heaven returns, give until I drop, preach until all know, and work until he comes. And when he comes to get his own, he will have no problem recognizing me. My colors will be clear. Amen. Are you a part of the fellowship of the unashamed? Did I just describe your life? And if I did, I want you to be encouraged this Easter. I want you to be encouraged. That's some good news for you. True belief results in a blessed life. After Jesus has this encounter with Thomas, and he says, stop doubting and believe. He goes on to share with his disciples, John 20, verse 29. Then Jesus told them, because you have seen me, you have believed. But listen to this. Blessed are those who have not seen, yet have believed. Jesus is talking about us. He says, blessed are those who have not seen, but have believed. I want you to be encouraged in your faith. That if you truly believe, Jesus says you are blessed. Those of you who live by faith and not by sight, you are blessed. God's favor is on your life. God is with you. God is for you. 2 Chronicles 16:9 says, for the eyes of the Lord move to and fro throughout the earth, that he may strongly support those whose heart is completely his. You are blessed. God is strongly supporting your life. You are a child of God. Your inheritance is in heaven. You will live forever with Jesus in a house that he is building for you. I want you to be encouraged. You are blessed. And then we get to the end of chapter 20, and the Apostle John gives us some encouragement. He tells us to keep believing, to continue in the faith. Verse 31 says, but these are written so that you may continue to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing in him, you'll have life by the power of his name. The encouragement to us is to continue to believe. And by believing, you'll have eternal life by the power of Jesus' name. We just sung about that. It's the power of Jesus' name. Keep believing, keep the faith. I wanna encourage you to walk with God for a lifetime. And I wanna close with this point, is true faith endures for a lifetime. It doesn't just last a season, it lasts a lifetime. Here's what the Apostle Paul said at the end of his life. I have fought the good fight, I have finished the race, I have kept the faith. Now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day. Not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. Keep believing. Keep fighting the good fight. Keep running the Christian race. The prize is Jesus. Your reward is heaven. There is a crown of righteousness waiting for you. If you truly believe, be encouraged this Easter. Keep believing, keep fighting the good fight. Keep running the Christian race and don't stop until you finish the finish line of heaven. Let me ask you again, do you believe in Jesus? And if you're not sure, I wanna encourage you to make sure today. We don't get to heaven through our good works. We don't get to heaven through jumping through certain spiritual hoops. We get to heaven through what Jesus Christ has done on the cross for us. Amen. Jesus said, it is finished, it is done, it is over. And Jesus gives his invitation to anyone and everyone. I love John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that whoever believes in him, whoever believes, it doesn't matter who you are, where you've been, what you've done, whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. I want to give you the opportunity right now to make sure that you are going to heaven, to put your faith in him. So let's all bow our heads and close our eyes. And if you're unsure of your salvation, and you want to put your faith in Jesus and you want to be sure today, then you can just pray this prayer in your heart after me. Lord Jesus, I believe that you are the Son of God. I believe that you lived a perfect life. I believe that you died on the cross for my sins. And I believe that you rose from the grave on the third day. I am putting my faith in you. I ask you to forgive me of my sins. I ask you to come into my life and radically change my life. I pray that the old life would be gone and I can live a new life in Christ. And we pray it all in Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, if you prayed that prayer, if you sincerely committed your life to Christ, then he's come into your life and he's changed your life. Hey, let's celebrate with all those who committed their lives to Christ today. So in the church, we have two ordinances, baptism, which we're celebrating today, and the Lord's Supper. Now underneath everyone's seat, we have the Lord's Supper package. I wanna ask you to reach down under your seat and grab the package. If you're not one in your seat and you need one, just raise your hand. We'll have one of the ushers bring you one. So both of the ordinances of the church are ways that we profess our faith. So baptism is a one-time profession of faith. It's our public profession of faith. But then the Lord's Supper is the ongoing profession of our faith. Jesus said to do this in remembrance of me. And so by taking the Lord's Supper, what you're saying is, I believe. You are confirming your faith. You're saying, I believe in Jesus. I believe in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus. And so as a church family, we're gonna share in the Lord's Supper together. So you can peel the top part off. And you can pull out the wafer. And Jesus broke the bread and said, this is my body. Do this in remembrance of me. So every time we eat of the bread, we are proclaiming the Lord's death. For Christ died for sins once and for all, the righteous for the unrighteous, to bring you to God. He was put to death in the body, but made alive by the Spirit. And so as we eat the bread together, let's focus on Christ crucified and thank Jesus for his death on the cross. And you can peel back the next layer. And the cup is symbolic of Jesus' blood that was shed for us. By his wounds, we have been healed. And without the shedding of blood, there can be no forgiveness of sins. And Jesus shed his blood for us. It's his blood that washes us as white as snow. And so as we drink from the cup, let's thank Jesus for shedding his blood for us. Let's pray together. God, as a church family, we're celebrating the Lord's Supper. We're so grateful for Christ crucified. We thank you, Jesus, for dying in our place. We thank you for your body. We thank you for your blood. We put our faith in you. And this Easter, God, we're celebrating the life and the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. We are confirming our faith that we believe. We pray it all in Jesus' name.
Church, if you would stand up, let's respond accordingly to sing about who we believe in.
creating one, and God Almighty, through your Holy Spirit, conceiving Christ the Son, and Jesus our Savior. I believe in God our Father, I believe in Christ the Son, I believe in the Holy Spirit, our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again, for I believe in the name of Jesus. Oh, I believe in the name of Jesus.
Our judge and our defender.
Like Jonathan said, what better way to celebrate baptisms than on Easter? So we have a line of people making that public confession of them accepting Jesus as their Lord and Savior. And so guys, they are a new creation. I love that verse, 2 Corinthians 5:17. For those that are in Christ Jesus, they are a new creation. And so we get to celebrate that today. And so we have Olivia and her mom, Kate.
This is Olivia, and I'm her mom, Katie, and she has decided to be baptized, and I think she has taught me more than anything about the love of God and Jesus. And are you ready to commit your life to Christ? And are you going to live? What is it?
And are you ready to live the rest of your life for Jesus?
Yes.
Fantastic.
Right. So in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
All right, yes. That's it, that's it.
Awesome. All right. We have a few more, guys. You know how, like, when you're at a football team or football game and you go nuts, you go crazy? Like, we should go even more crazy, right? So this is people who have put their faith in Christ and made a decision to live for him for the rest of their life. And so this is Laquita. Laquita's been coming to Graystone for, you know, several months now. And she's got some family here celebrating with her. And it's crazy, like early on before she got on stage, there was a couple of times I absolutely butchered her name, but yet we're still friends. So I really appreciate Grace. It's Laquita, yes. And she just gave me the eye, you know, no, anyways. She wanted me to share a couple of things really quick. She grew up, she actually got saved around 12 years old. Actually got baptized at a young age and doesn't remember it. She grew up in a Pentecostal church. In that church, there was a lot of, you know, legalism and a lot of rules and a lot of things that just, it was Jesus and something else. And so she wants to get re-baptized because she knows it now. She's making a real life decision from where God has taken her up to this point. And she wanted to make sure that you knew, and with her, she's living in freedom and she desires God with every fiber of her being. And so I'm so thankful to be able to baptize you, Laquita, and the group. We've had some great conversations these past couple of days. And so I'm going to ask you two questions. Have you committed your life to Jesus?
Yes.
I baptize you. Hold on. The next one is, do you commit to following Jesus for the rest of your life?
Yes.
By your profession of faith, I baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Good morning. So this is Shakur, and Chad Finley and I have the pleasure of leading a small group, 8th grade and 7th grade, but Shakur's 8th grade. And what he has shown us over the time that we get to be his leaders, we talk about all the time that they bless us and we learn from them. And but we've watched him grow. He's super mature, but one thing that he exemplifies more than anything is that love of Christ. He knows that that's what's important, is that we love God and we love people. We're super proud of you. He's an outstanding young man. Just look at him. He just got the best smile. So Shakur, I have two questions. Have you committed your life to Christ?
Yes.
And do you promise to follow him the rest of your days?
Yes.
Then I get to baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Hey everyone, good morning. Happy Easter. I want to introduce to y'all Bradley Gilbert. Bradley is, I've known Bradley about 3 years. Lord brought him into my life. He was my neighbor. You know, God commands us to love our neighbors. And so God just really put a special place in my heart for Bradley. I saw Bradley as an 8-9-year-old boy with some internal struggles. With some struggles in his identity, but I knew that day that God put a purpose in my heart to love Bradley and to teach Bradley about Christ and how to have a love for him. And so over the years, God put a special place in my heart for Brett and Sam and Sawyer, his mother, dad, and stepmother, dad, and brother. And as you know, I was here about 2 years ago, a little under 2 years ago, and I got to baptize Brett in this same place. And on that day, I talked a little bit about love and how it means to put the I on love you. The world has kind of watered it down, and I talked to the men about being able to share I love you. And on that day, we went back to Brett's house, and we were celebrating, eating some good food. And when we were leaving, or I was leaving, Bradley looked at me, and he said, "Clancy, remember this. And tell me what you said."
"I love you."
And I knew that day that God had begun something inside Bradley. So almost 3 years later, he's a part of our student ministry group. He's in our sixth grade boys group. We got a couple of our boys standing over here. Austin's here. Big Josh is on the stage. We get to love on these boys. And as Jake said, it's a tremendous blessing how they bless us. But through the years, we've just watched Bradley grow. There's been some rough days. There's been some incredible days. And I now see Bradley as a youngster that has some internal struggles, but he knows his identity is 100% in Christ. And he has a hope for today and a promise for tomorrow. And that's exciting to me. We challenge our boys, our sixth grade boys, with a lot of truth. And today I'm just excited to be able to stand before you with Austin and Josh and our other brothers and tell you we love you. So I have two questions for you. Have you given your heart to Jesus?
Yes.
And do you commit to spending the rest of your days for him?
Yes.
So it's my privilege and honor, my brother, to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Today, and I think he's going to continue to move. And so, in fact, I know this is probably going to be said earlier or in a moment, but if God's stirring in your heart, you're like, "Man, what's the next step?" We have baptism in the next service. So I don't know what it is for you, but God's moving. And so, hey, we're going to sing one more song. If you guys would stand up, Jesus is too good to not believe. Let's sing about our belief once again. That have proved your faithfulness. I've seen miracles my mind can't comprehend. And there is beauty in what I can't understand. Jesus, it's you. Jesus, it's you. I believe. I believe you're the wonder working. The wonder-working God, all the miracles I've seen, too good to not believe. The wonder-working God, and you heal because you love. Oh, the miracles I've seen, too good to not believe. Too good to not believe. Too good to not believe. Resurrect a man with my own hands. Just the mention of your name can raise the dead.
Come on.
And all the glory to the only one who can. And Jesus.
will see. Too good to not believe. Too good to not believe. Too good to not believe. After everything I've seen, you're too good to not believe. Too good to not believe. Too good to not believe. We've seen cancer disappear. We've seen broken bodies healed. Don't you tell me he can't do it. Don't you tell me he can't do it. We've seen real life resurrection. We've seen mental health restored. Don't you tell me he can't do it. Don't you tell me he can't do it. We've seen families reunited. We've seen prodigals return. And don't you tell me he can't do it. You tell me he can't do it. We've seen troubled souls deliver. We've seen addicts finally free. Yeah. Don't you tell me he can't do it. Don't you tell me he can't do it. We'll see cities in revival. And salvation flood the streets. Don't you tell me he can't do it. Don't you tell me.
So much for singing with us.
You can have a seat. What a privilege it is to be in the Lord's house today, and we're so glad that you are here with us. No matter where you are on your spiritual journey, whether you're like baby steps, barely here today, or you've walked with God a long time, we have a place for you here. We'd love for you to walk it out. Walk out your salvation with us. Will you stay with us? We would love for you to fill out your communication card. And if you're a first-time guest and you fill that out and put it in the offering bucket that's going to pass in just a second, we will donate $5 in your honor as a way to say thank you to the Southeast Co-op, which is a local food bank, and that would be wonderful. But you can also write other things on that card. Maybe today you committed your life to Jesus for the first time. Or maybe like Laquita, you rededicated, like, okay, I was baptized earlier, I had a faith journey earlier, but today or recently, it's become real to me and I want to live it out. Let us know that. Or maybe you're ready for baptism. We do it every month. like Pastor Josh said, we will have it next service if you want to stick around. But we can do it in the future. If you want to talk with someone about baptism, we would love to do that with you as well. Write that down. Write down prayer requests. We love to pray for you. Write those down as well. Thank you for your generosity toward our church. We're able to do amazing things in our church and outside the walls of our church. And we're about to take up the offering again. We just want to thank you for being so generous. Let's pray together. Dear God, we are grateful. We serve a risen King. God, so many of us are walking a journey today that is hard, complicated. But when we come into your house and into your presence, we feel peace, and we're so grateful for that. And we pray for everybody in the room today that we would know your love, that we would know your blessing, God, and that we could walk out of this room with confidence and with peace. We thank you for providing for us and for providing for our church through the tithes and offerings. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, as the offering buckets are being passed, I want to let you know that every week at Graystone is great. So we want you to come back next week, and we have a really great service series, and it's a parenting series. So check out this video. I'm not going to lie, I got a little teary-eyed when the college graduate walked off. We know what that's like, many of us. So anyway, our parenting series is going to be something for everyone. It's going to be wonderful. Please come back, invite your friends. On the flip side of that card that was in your seats, we're announcing that sports camp is back first week of June like it was pre-COVID. We're going to have a full week. It's going to be a blast, and registration is open. It's our version of Vacation Bible School. Your kids come up here at night. They have tons of fun and learn about Jesus. Invite your friends, your neighbors, and of course, we want all of y'all to help and volunteer. So it's going to be great. Hope you have a great day. Happy Easter. We love y'all.